Whoops. Knocked the mic. This is VK3SL. Welcome to our evening session today. And we are back again. Not entirely in the best state of mind. It's been a very liquid evening. Tonight, we've had a big social event here. Family social event. But it has been quite absorbing in many respects. But that's okay, we'll hold up and persevere. And preceding that, we had a fantastic week. Amazing time over the last few days, walking in the prom. So finding sort of places apart from where everybody else is engaging. It's nice to sort of try and find an individual space at the prom, but that's the challenge, but with the prom being so popular. But we did do that, and we had a wonderful walk, and it was thoroughly invigorating. It was just amazing, actually. So, yeah, it's a good space to be. Well, back to the coalface, and I don't think we'll be doing our afternoon emissions for some time because other events are sort of cropping up thick and fast. So we probably will put that on hold until next year, and we may reinvigorate that space as an OTR event. That's on the cards. And so that's the only news to date. Haven't been in here for a while. I'm pleased to hear that all systems are sort of working, which is sort of a slight surprise because you never know here. Anyhow, what do we have? First cab off the rank is King Oliver and his orchestra, recording a test pressing put up by Mr. Dello on YouTube. It's worth hearing. It's quite great. It features Mr. Higginbottom on the trombone and others. Charlie Holmes on the soprano sax and Louis Metcalf and on the cornet, I think, as well as Mr. Oliver himself in the ensemble. Anyhow, I think it's a vinyl pressing. It's pretty clear. That sounds great. So let's kick off with this today, and we hopefully will sort of take, hopefully we'll be on board for a session with Frank shortly in about half an hour after I get settled. So this is VK3SL testing on 160 and also on 2 meters, as well as streaming online. You can find the YouTube stream under my call sign. Now, let's hear Mr. Oliver and co. Thank you. Okay, that finished earlier than I thought it would. That's King Oliver and his orchestra, The Trumpet's Prayer. It's an HMV test pressing, and it did feature the trumpet solos of Louis Metcalf, as well as the great J.C. Higginbottom on the bone, the dog and bone. Anyhow, the trumpet solo was very reminiscent of Mr. Armstrong, of course. Anyhow, that's it. That's the King Oliver and his orchestra. We'll follow on with some Mr. Collier. Jacob Collier has featured very strong in my listening while behind the wheel over the last few days. So we'll hear something from his Jesse Volume 2. It's a track called Lure, and it features a lot of Collier's famous dynamicism. This is VK3SL testing.
Vou-me embora, ver a lua, ver a noite a passar, até o sol nascer. Diz-me que vens para me ver. Diz-me que vens para ficar. Já não sei se espero por ti, se estou a sonhar. See the light, see it all around the head.
some things cannot be. What we want them to be.
See the light, see the light, yeah. See the light, see the light. See the light, see the light, yeah. See the light, see the light. See the light, see the light. See the light, see it all in. 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 See the light, see it all in my head. See the light, see it all in. See the light, see it all in my head. See the light, see it all in. See the light, see it all in my head. See the light, see it all in. See the light, see it all in my head. See the light, see it all in. See the light, see it all in my head.
Featuring vocals by Maro as Jacob Collier from his album Jesse 2. Mr. Collier features very strongly in this household. We listen to him a lot, and I'm always just transfixed by the remarkable depth of his imagination and arrangements. Well, we're getting sorted here, slowly but surely. Getting back into the realm. And what do we have on the table? We have a message from the Department of Post-COVID Reconstruction. Yeah, this follows on from our last message. When was it? Our last session on Monday, I think it was. And afternoon session. So I think we'll play it again just for old time's sake. This is VK3SL, and I'm about to start now. I think we're ready to go. Right, turntable. And
I was a labourer, message boy, truck driver, a builder. I was a reporter, a student, a musician. Yes, I'm one man, yet I'm all men. Right now, I'm wearing jungle green up in New Guinea, oil-stained overalls in a munition factory. Dungarees dirty with the red dust of the outback. Yes, I'm all of those men. And when I come back from the war, when the munition factories no longer want me, I'll be needing a job. Will there be one for me? Or will it be the same as after the last war?
What a life! Plenty of jobs, plenty of money.
Yeah, but look at the prices. They've skyrocketed. It's crazy. It can't last.
1921.
I told you it wouldn't last. Look how things are now. We're in for a depression.
Oh, it's only temporary. Things will pick up. You'll see.
1927.
There you are. I knew everything would be all right. The papers say we've made a recovery. A slow one, sure, but we're on the right track.
1929.
So we've recovered. Recovered for what? The worst depression in the history of the world.
Yes, I guess you're right. What was the use of the war? We've won it with our blood, yet we've lost the peace through our neglect.
1930, 1932, 1933, 34, 35. Long, slow years of unemployment, hunger and want. Slowly, but oh how slowly, the nation made its recovery. By 1939, Australia had struggled towards reasonable prosperity. Unemployment figures had dropped. The sun shone again. Then, war.
Excuse me, but I'll take over from here. War is the people's business. We're the ones who win it or lose it. That we will win, there's no doubt. But will we win the peace? That, too, is our business.
May I interrupt?
Well, it depends on what you have to say. Who are you?
Call me Reconstruction. Post-war Reconstruction.
Your title sounds impressive. What have you to tell us?
Plenty. I have a plan for the peace. I'd like you to tell me what you think of it.
I will.
First of all, there's your job, the one we've planned for you after the war. During the war, The Australian industry expanded by leaps and bounds. Full use must be made of that industry so that there will be full and continuous employment for all.
That sounds intelligent.
It's not enough to make work available for every man and woman requiring it, but it must be the right work for the individual.
I fully agree.
Many will want training for their job, educating for their professions. University and technical college courses will be open for those eligible. They will receive training, books, living allowances, at the government's expense.
You have planned well.
Thank you. Then there's the housing problem. Slums must go, and in their place, there must be solid, modern, hygienic houses of which a man may be justly proud. The people must have social protection from economic setbacks of sickness and disability. The people must develop in a land that is free from, as the Atlantic Charter puts it, free from want, freedom from fear.
That's the post-war Australia we want.
That is the post-war Australia you'll get. But remember, the task will not be easy. Nothing is ever easy in this world. These tasks Australia will face are so big that they must be planned on a national basis. But carrying the plans through to action will tax the resources of all our authorities, whether they are Commonwealth, state or local. Remember, only we the people can help to realize this. It's up to us.
You have been listening to a program presented by the Ministry of Post-War Reconstruction.
Post-COVID reconstruction, indeed. There we go. A bit of propaganda from the archives there, courtesy of Mr. J. And we'll follow through with another selection from our non-sponsors while I'm slowly thawing out and getting sorted here. Just sent Mr. Frank a Zoom invite, so we'll usher him into the fold very shortly. This is VK3SL test missions on 160 and on 2 metres. It's a bit of a slow start today. I've been away and I'm pretty tired. Been hiking for 4 days and only came back at about 6 p.m. to find myself descend upon a big party vibe here. Lots of people, lots of liquid refreshment. And so it's sort of one experience capitulating into the next. So that's the way of things. But we will survive. And here is an advertisement, I think I'm testing. Anyhow, let's have a listen.
To the thousands of families who have always wanted an His Master's Voice radio receiver, we're glad to announce that a complete range of new models is now available at prices which are no higher than you would pay for any other make of radio. In addition, His Master's Voice radio this year embraces a variety of valuable technical features which enable you to get splendid shortwave reception, as well as Australian stations, quicker and easier than ever before. It's important to note that the new console models incorporate the increasingly important 13-meter band. And furthermore, provision is made for the new wavelength allocations, which become available in September next. As this involves the extension of the normal or medium wave band, the space reserved for these wavelengths is plainly indicated on the new dials. His Master's Voice radio is therefore modern, in every sense of the word. Examine the exquisite cabinet work. Look at the large and powerful chassis, in which is embodied every modern improvement known to radio science. And thrill to the famous His Master's Voice true-to-life tone quality, the result of 40 years' knowledge, experience, and leadership in the world of music. The history of His Master's Voice has been one of constant improvement and development in sound reproducing instruments and records. And the name, His Master's Voice, on a radio is a guarantee of quality and efficiency. The entire range of His Master's Voice radios is sensational in style, in tone, in beauty, and in price. See and hear these new models today for the latest and best in radio.
And don't forget to listen on the 13-meter band. That's some radio nostalgia, courtesy of our HMV sponsors. There's another track on this record. I think it's a locked disc, so I might just scoot over and see if I can release the locked disc, a locked track, and find track two, and we'll see if we've got some other offering. Looks like we do.
My blessing fall on this fair world, on mountain, valley, forest, ocean.
The song is ended, but the melody lingers on. How often have you wished you could hear it again? The privilege and pleasure of being able to do this can now be yours. You can enjoy encores of your favorite artists to your heart's content if you own one of the new His Master's Voice record players, which plugs into your radio and transforms it into what is virtually a radio and gramophone combination. You can get an His Master's Voice record player for as low as £4.19. Ask your nearest radio dealer about it.
Say no more. There we have it. That's quite exceptional. Well, we're very fortunate here to have the support of Mr. J, who's been sending me recordings and sharing his collection. It's been a wonderful treat. So greetings to you, Jamie, and also to Mr. F, who is standing on the sidelines, I think. So, as per usual, I will usher Frank in with an OTR offering, or a chapel disc offering, I should say. So I think we're right to go. Yes. And we'll see if we can make progress. Okay, there we have it. That is our entrant, and I'm wondering if Frank is there. Can you hear me, Mr. F? I wonder. Ah, let's see. Have I got everything switched in? That's right. I can see my Oh, I've got to admit you to the room. Sorry, Frank. Here we go. I've admitted you into the room. Can you hear me? I wonder. Looks like you might be up.
Yes.
You're there.
Here I am.
How are you, Frank?
I'm very well. Very well, thank you. Great to hear your voice again.
Well, gosh, I'm only sort of half here tonight. But look, we'll do the best we can.
Half is quite enough.
I don't know about that. Yes, last night I was sound asleep. The thing is that when you with the hiking, you go to bed at 6:30. O'clock, and it's being physically exhausted. You sleep 12-hour nights, and
amazingly healthy, I should think. That
well, it's great, it's good, but I'm sort of in a partially celebratory, post-celebratory zone, but also in a very soporific post 6:30 zone.
So, did you find yourself running out of energy before Henry, or is that not a problem?
Oh, he's got far more energy than I have.
But look, yes, well, it's to be expected.
It is to be expected. That's it. Yes, now he's fit and healthy. But look, it was good. It was really a wonderful week. We had a fabulous walk. We walked about 20 kilometres a day.
And, wow, that's a serious walk.
Well, you know, and look, some of it was with, the distance between camping spots wasn't very far, but there were lots of other places to explore. So it was fantastic, and we were able to escape most of the crowds, which was wonderful. And
good.
Several swims, and it's a beautiful place, and there's a, it's, you know, those beaches are just magical. They're expansive. They're all the major beaches on the east side of the Prom. They're about a couple of kilometres long. So you can really just walk and walk. And when the weather's right, which it was most of the time, I was just reading a book and walking, and I didn't need to look anything, look around, because it's just, you're never going to trip over, because it's such a vast area you're walking in.
Yes. And it's become very popular, hasn't it?
Look, the Prom is very popular. Unfortunately, it's the place to be.
It's been discovered.
It has, well and truly. A long time ago, and even more so this year, because everyone's sort of eager to get out.
So keen to get out.
That's true. And but look, even then, we saw very few people. And we're able to sort of, find our own zone. And it was good. It was just really relaxing. I read a whole book. I read Gerald Moore's biography, Am I Too Loud?
Am I Too Loud? Oh, I must read that.
It's such a great read. Oh, I was compelled. I couldn't keep my eyes off it. It was just a wonderful book. And I was walking along the beach backwards and forwards and reading and and digesting the stories. The stories of one of the greatest accompanists of all time, really.
Oh, I think so. Yeah. I heard an interview with him. You may have even put it on, where he's interviewed in detail about the book.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And
yeah.
And talks about some of the various people that the greats that he accompanied, all the greats pretty much.
He did. He was sort of the foremost accompanist of his era, really. He just accompanied everyone. Yeah. He was very sought after. But it's a very modest book. He's very self-effacing, and it's fascinating. And his insights are very, I like his wavelength. It resonates with me. He's looking for the musicianship. He's looking for the deeper connection with the music, the emotional investment. And for me, that sort of was what I want to hear. So I think in future missions, I'll be keen to sort of seek out some of the great recordings that he made with various notable performers, and
if you could
them.
Find this interview, this documentary,
sure,
that would make great listening.
Mm.
I'm sure people would be interested in that.
Yeah, definitely.
He dissects what an accompanist should be like, what they should do. Yeah. Well, you've read it, you know.
That's it. Well, it's very much about being an associate artist, so, having equal billing. He was very much one for sort of emancipating the accompanist and bringing the role of the accompanist to the same role as the soloist. So And it's great, because suddenly the music has so much more meaning if it's a real dialogue rather than a sort of, master-student sort of situation.
Yeah, so just a vehicle for the soloist to ride on, sort of thing.
That's right, and he sort of alludes to the fact that that was very much the thinking in the 19th century, and and that sort of state of affairs changed a lot, and I can understand.
Yet the accompaniments themselves are very often very beautiful.
Mm. Yeah, so much so. And he was very famous for his work with Schubert and Schumann songs and Brahms Lieder and as an accompanist. The investment in the word painting and the text and the complexities of the text and the way the text sort of was brought out through the music was very much to the fore. And it's really compelling. I mean, it makes you want to sort of understand the story behind the songs.
And, absolutely.
So that's a sort of a new point of departure for me, I think.
Oh, that's wonderful. Did you take a radio with you at all?
I didn't. I deliberately didn't.
Well done.
I felt that if I'd taken a radio, I wouldn't have spent so much time on the book. I needed to sort of break out from everything to do with technical stuff and just be in that zone. And I yearned for it a bit, I have to say.
I know. Well, you withdrawal symptoms, but still, you managed without it, you see. So you've proved that.
That's right. That's important. No, I've done that walk, these walks at the prom many times, and I've always had a wireless in shoe, but not this time. So, we went minimalist. We didn't take much in our backpacks at all. And
how about food?
Just dried food. You can get dried meats, sort of beef jerky type meats, and just mix them with noodles.
Do you rehydrate them, or do you just eat them?
You sort of do. I have a little gas stove, and you just heat up the noodles and put the meat in with it, and it's very easy to make a meal. And a meal only takes 5 minutes to make, and it's easy to clean up, and it's straightforward. And it was fine. We had plenty of food. And,
did you feel the need of energy food, like extra chocolate and that sort of stuff?
Oh, there's always room for extra chocolate, Frank. That's an absolute given.
You can go without radio, but you can't go without chocolate.
Absolutely. I'm a registered chocoholic. No.
Me too.
No, the Toblerone had prime place in their backpack.
Oh, yes. That's lovely.
So that was very good. So anyhow, it was lovely. It was really good. We're very lucky because during the sort of waking hours, the weather was quite good. But at night, it was wild. It was wild as. We had horizontal rain and just really incredible weather. We're thinking, how are we going to get back on the road? But then it miraculously sort of clears up at about 9 a.m., and then everything's fine. So that's the way it was.
Didn't go to turn to mud.
Oh, well, it's very sandy, sort of loamy.
Oh, so it soaks it up.
It does. So that wasn't a problem. We didn't have any. We had a little bit of flooding. I got the tent flooded out at one point, but the sleeping mats are sort of elevated a little bit, so they're okay.
Yeah.
But look, that's fine. It was sort of four seasons in a day a little bit.
Yeah.
And the remarkable thing was you could get these, at one point it would be just, it would be like in the middle of winter, freezing cold, horizontal rain, just absolutely wild weather. And in within a few hours, it was 26 degrees, not a breath of wind at all. And just perfect. So, it was just enjoying the two experiences. And I love the wild weather. I mean, I rag up just experiencing nature in all its glory is something I just relish. I love it.
It's very thrilling. As long as you still feel safe.
Yeah, as long as you can be dry and safe, then it's all okay. Yeah.
I got caught in a very heavy thunderstorm at one point, and I was a bit concerned about the lightning.
Okay, I can understand that. Yeah, it can be a problem, especially if you're in an open area without.
That's that. Well, it wasn't quite open, but we were camping.
Yeah, sure.
And it was a bit hairy, but we survived quite well.
Okay. Yeah.
And there is an amazing. I used to love going out into storms. So and I used to take my kids out to the, you know, on the front porch when they're, and they developed a love of it as well.
Yeah, it's just wonderful experiencing nature in its full expression, isn't it? Just the the visceral side of it, the feeling of it, the vibrations. Yeah. Now, didn't we have a wonderful missions last week?
It was superb. It was one of the best ever, I think.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. It was great. It was really good. So, Jamie, if you're listening, thank you. And it was a really great session. We'll look forward to having another live missions in time. And well, certainly in sooner than later, we'll be able to work via Zoom. Well, but the
perhaps that's right. But we perhaps every 3 or 4 months get together.
Yeah,
or
I think
like
so.
That.
I think so. Yeah, it would be really good because it was just great to be able to be in the presence of each other. So yeah. So if anyone's interested, we did do a live session last week, and it's all on the log. So if you go to the website VK3SL website, you'll find it there. Not website, YouTube channel. So.
Yeah.
So it's all there, and it's worth listening to because Jamie just had so much remarkable material to share. It was great.
He's quite encyclopedic, it's wonderful to just listen to him, really, because I learn so much.
Yeah, likewise, absolutely, I do, and it's enlivening, really, just to get that insight into the history of the medium, and such a comprehensive history too, just to hear about artists and the recordings. Yeah, that was good. Really good.
Likewise. Thank you for organising and making it possible.
It worked really well. It was good fun. Yeah, so that's probably the news of the week, and we'll probably withhold afternoon sessions. We might reinvigorate them in some other form probably won't be until February or thereabouts. But
okay. Well, you can always bring them back anytime you...
I think I'll bring them back with an OTR, particularly with interesting sort of, I mean, I'm really compelled by the shadow, and I've got lots of Life of Dexter's here now, so we could play those, and we'll just go through the collection and enjoy them, I think, and celebrate in, OTR, particularly OTR that captures the flavour of the times. I like some of it can be a bit staid and a bit... not so sort of involving, but other materials.
Well, again, that was really part of the times a bit. They were fairly conservative, and
yes, I think by nature they often were. But look, that's okay, and I love the accents. I love the modes of delivery, the interactions. It says so much about Australia at that time, I think, and it certainly was.
I think the standard of radio acting in Australia is absolutely second to none.
Mm. Yeah,
and obviously they're reading it, so it's perhaps not, in some ways not as demanding as somebody who learns lines and recites them or acts them out. But nevertheless, it's still a great credit to them that they're able to sound so convincing.
Yeah,
and
absolutely. Definitely it is. Yeah. So anyhow, we'll certainly keep on that frontier because it's an interesting journey. Yeah. So Frank, what's your news? What's been happening in your neck of the woods?
I've been having a very hectic time and barely surviving.
Okay.
It started really on, Friday.
Mm-hmm.
With the long missions.
That's right. Well, we went until about 4:30. So the next day, because you had a roller coaster a few days after that, didn't you?
Yeah, I did. I had the radio club party.
Yes,
it was a spit roast barbecue-y sort of thing,
mm-hmm.
and there were a lot of people there, and that was very interesting.
Good.
We've had some turmoil within the clubs. I think you're aware.
It
certainly didn't in any way detract from the enjoyment of the barbecue and the level of friendship and harmony that was there.
Yeah,
and I thoroughly enjoyed that.
Mm.
Because
that was the Christmas breakup, wasn't it? The next day.
That was the Christmas breakup.
Well,
yeah.
You did well attending that.
I was pretty whacked when I got home.
I bet you were. Yeah. Yeah.
And then Sunday I had a big family lunch.
Okay.
In a pub, and we had 20 odd people there.
Hmm.
And that was most pleasant as well.
Good. And then Monday I had, was that at the local park? Was that at the in your?
No, that was at a pub in Port Melbourne.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yes,
that sounds good.
It's an annual event. That's where we have it.
Yeah, yeah.
And they took the booking for 20 odd. I can't remember
that's good. Yeah.
How many. But that was most pleasant. People that I perhaps some of them I only see once a year.
Sure.
They're relatives of relatives sort of thing, mm-hmm. some of them.
Mm-hmm.
But caught up with all my cousins.
Great. That's good.
On my father's side. So very pleasant. And then Monday I had another lunch with some lawyer friends that I've been very close to since going through law school with them.
Okay.
Three of them. One died a little while ago.
Okay.
So our numbers are gradually going down.
That would have been a bit. So was this the first time you'd met up since that person had passed away?
Yes, it was actually. Mm,
that could be quite harrowing.
It was a bit of a wrench. Yeah.
We
spent some time talking about Max. And,
okay. Sure.
It was good. But so that was most enjoyable.
Okay.
And,
all right.
And then we had a visit from Patrick and Tanya and the grandkids.
Mm-hmm.
When was that? Last night.
Okay.
They call every year to see our Christmas lights. We have our street makes a bit of a feature of Christmas lights.
Okay. Oh, fantastic. And, I'll have to have a look.
Yeah, if you get time, wander over. We even have things like arches happening.
Mm. Very good. And excellent.
It's wonderful, yeah.
Right. Is it something that people plan together, or is it how does it sort of manifest? Is it sort of
both? We've got main organisers who sort of stir it along, but then a lot of it is just people off their own bat. Keeping up by doing, doing a bit.
Sure.
Doing various amounts.
Yeah.
Some are perhaps a little over the top and some do very little.
Sure.
So it's a variety, but there is a central sort of core of people who help it along.
Okay.
We've got a couple of engineers who are to the fore and...
very good, Frank. That sounds excellent. It sounds like a really colourful street.
Yeah. We have people come. We get busloads of people from elderly people's facilities and things like that.
I might take my younger ones for a bit of a drive.
And call in, say hello.
Sure.
If you do.
No, that'd be. That sounds great. And do they light up the trees? Because you've got some beautiful plane trees in your street, don't
yes,
you?
Yes, yes. They've got things in trees. And,
very good. So on the verge as well as the houses are lit up. Aren't
yes,
they?
Yes, yes, yes. Oh mm. yes, yes, yes. We've got solar lights.
Okay. Terrific.
So that's very good.
Oh, that's very good. So LED lights have sort of made all this a lot easier, haven't they, really?
Hugely easier because they don't wreck to any degree, like the little globes.
That's right.
And they're easily put up, relatively easily put up.
Sure.
And they're not expensive.
Hmm. That's the way to go. That's good. No, nice.
And our grandkids love them, of course.
I'm sure they do. Yeah, that's excellent.
The 7-year-old is particular. Well, they both love them actually. But
the
7-year-old's at an interesting stage. She's at the stage where she's, as the song says, just about ready to say goodbye to the dolls.
Yeah. Oh, that's a sad step. I lament that step because I've recorded my kids a lot and in here.
Yes, I know.
And they used to bring dolls and toys in all the time, and they used to feature in the stories. And I used to really relish in that. I love the sort of the three-dimensional quality to it. And then once the dolls go, it all sort of starts to change, and then they start to become older people, which is normal, which is completely normal.
Yeah, absolutely.
But at the same time, it's that loss of innocence and everything.
She's not quite there. She showed me where their latest acquisition is a shark, Gordon the Shark.
Okay.
A stuffed shark.
Okay. Yay. Well, it's tricky. I know. We had to have a discussion with our youngest, who is, how old is Celia now? She's 10. And we had to say that I've been in dialogue with Santa, I said. And
yes, I know. It's tricky, isn't it?
It is, and it was sort of de-santifying things a little bit. We sort of kept a
You've
bit
got
of
to take
a mystery.
It slowly, if you or gradually, I think.
I know, because the rest of them, they all know, but she still has that lovely fantasy, and I don't want to diminish that at all. But there has to be a few reality sort of dimensions to it. So we're slowly culturing her, but it's again, it's another sort of loss of innocence, which I feel a bit sad about.
Yeah. It is all very sad, but it's inevitable, it's tricky because you get smart Alec kids who at school who sort of delight in trying to wreck it for other kids.
That's right. Well, it's sort of, I can preserve my delusion by doing this, but jeez.
That's right.
Yes. Anyhow,
I think the elder sister who's 9, I think she probably is very suspicious of it, but she's not, she's not disillusioning Sophia at all.
Yeah,
so.
Okay. Well, that's good. If there can be sort of a comfortable sort of stay, keep the mystery alive as long as possible, as what I think.
Absolutely.
Yes, and our family is sort of becomes an issue of consistency as they get much
yes.
older.
I know. It gets trickier.
We have to sort of try and verify and validate, and anyhow, it doesn't quite match up, doesn't it? The logic starts to kick in, unfortunately, that logical thinking.
I'm afraid it did. It kicked in a bit earlier than it should have with me, because I was of that nature of being a questioner.
Yes. You're curious and you're wondering, what does the Santa really do?
How could he possibly do all this?
They
had to admit that he had a lot of helpers.
That's been my excuse. Yes. Yeah. We've always had two gifts under the tree, one from us and one from Santa. Now, the Santa one's
that's
always
wonderful.
Yeah, well, it's been the way we've tried to do it. And the Santa gift always has a curly language, a curly sort of weird writing that I've invented.
Oh, that's wonderful.
That sort of worked for a while, but the subterfuges, we're starting to get to the point where we think the kids just need one gift, not two. So
yes,
we're sort of trying to put things into perspective. So, yeah, there's the challenge.
Anyway, it's wonderful to spend Christmas with them, and they're coming over Christmas Day.
Oh, good. Okay, so you'll have a family Christmas at your place, I gather.
Yes, we will. Yes.
Oh, very good.
That's great.
Yeah, so excellent. Oh, good on you, Frank.
We've got the elder one. My son bought the elder one a cricket set because she loves playing with the bat and ball.
Yeah, why not? Yeah.
So, well, this is the era of equality, and
of course it is. Absolutely. Well, it's a bit of a beach culture, isn't there, of playing.
Very much so.
I noticed a lot of people at the prom playing beach cricket as I was walking around. I was very keen to get to the other end of Norman Bay. But that's okay. I did have a few moments of observing. I do enjoy observing the sort of communities and the camping communities. It makes me sort of think about when I see this tent city there, I think of the gold rush and the way they would have had it. Just imagine.
I'm reading a book at the moment about a mine in South Africa in the 19th century.
And really?
About the shanties and the huts that they all, the cast iron sort of huts that they lived in with. Iron sheeting and
the
squalor and all that. I won't go into it now, but it is actually a very good book.
Sounds fascinating. Yeah. Those historical takes, can really... It can be very compelling, that the subject matter and sort of trying to imagine the way that, especially the way that communities operated and the way that people interacted and how they met their needs. Yeah, I find that. Go on. Yeah.
Go ahead.
No, I find the gold rush the history of our gold rush just such a fascinating subject. Just the whole thought of so many people from different ethnicities and having to sort of all working together and make lives for themselves and coerce and make things function, because they couldn't quite extraordinary. Yeah.
My great-grandfather, or might have been great-great, was sergeant of police at Castle Maine during the gold rush.
Really?
He was.
Wow. And, what a fascinating connection.
And we have in the family these wonderful artifacts, which are all sorts of Chinese basketry, very fine, very delicate basketry and pottery that he acquired.
Wow!
I'm not sure how. I suspect our best theory is that he turned a bit of a blind eye to the opium smoking that they
doing. Interesting. Wonderful, wonderful artifacts. How about that? That's great.
Yeah, it is great. Yeah.
Goodness me. Well, so, yeah, look, just, to think of these poor people displaced over such distance trying to preserve their integrity and preserve the essence of their culture while trying to, having to sort of work in without very little sort of domestic assistance
quite remarkable, really.
When I did my last year of school, I did a history topic, and I did some research on the gold fields in Talbot near Talbot is a little, because now ghost town, there's nothing much left of it, but it was near Clunes, and there was a very big rush there in 1859. 30,000 people came there, and the whole town just sort of sprung out of nothing, like as it happened everywhere. But in Clunes, in Talbot, there was quite a community, and it existed well into the 20th century, and there was still a main street full of sort of abandoned buildings. Anyhow, I found 400 glass plate photographs under the stage of the town hall. And I set up. And I had it at that time. I was into photography. I had my own dark room in my bedroom, and I got a yellow filter and a copying stand, and I brought it down there, and I just copied stacks of these pictures. And they go back to the 1860s. They go way, way back on glass plates. They were just amazing pictures, and you just get this because they're so high res. These extraordinary insights into the communities, the way people dressed, the way the people looked. And one picture just arrested me, and it was a picture of a shop in Scandinavian Crescent, which was the main street of Talbot, and it said Piano and Organ Warehouse.
Oh, no.
In about 1860. Just to think that they actually had a piano shop.
I guess it's indicative of there being a lot of money around.
There must have, absolutely. Yeah, but to think that they hauled pianos and had enough to sustain a shop in the middle of nowhere. I mean,
it is. It's remarkable.
It is.
You'd expect there to be, that they'd want an organ for their church. And a piano maybe for their community hall.
For their community hall, that's right.
And you'd think that'd be about it, wouldn't you?
Yeah, yeah. But here's a shop dedicated to selling pianos, and it was on the front. I couldn't believe it. It absolutely blew my mind. And it just sort of suggested how dynamic these communities were. And there were other things like wallpaper shops. And the building I stayed in belonged to a friend of my parents, and it was very, very run down. But it had been a hotel back in the early days. Mm. Anyhow, I climbed up into the ceiling, and the wallpaper was about 6 or 7 layers thick, and it all was sort of broken away. And I took some samples.
They just kept papering over.
Yeah, they did.
Over and over.
Yeah, it was over Hessian. It was over Hessian because they didn't have plaster.
Yes.
I was able to sort of tease this out and get the different styles of wallpapers. But before the turn of the century, they were wallpapering their building every 5 years to 10 years.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No. Look, we had. I grew up in a little maisonette in South Melbourne.
Yeah.
And we had wallpaper, and Dad used to do it. Okay. And I reckon, about every 5 or 10 years anyway.
Wow, that's amazing, isn't it, to think that sort of pride, that sense of, you know, we're up with the times, where we've got an impeccable sense of style. This is our domain. I just find that sort of thing really, I mean, in this day and age, it's a very different sort of... I suppose people express themselves similarly in some respects, but every 5 years updating, and it was incredible. And these were heavily embossed, really sort of, you know, out there wallpapers.
Oh, yes.
And
they,
um,
it was,
with bold designs, big floral designs, and imagine a small room with these massive big flowerets and roses and things and really rich colours, and it was incredible. I just found and then as you sort of move into the 20th century, it became more and more conservative. It was interesting.
Yes.
And the last layer was from the 1930s, which was all very utilitarian and very sort of,
practical.
Yeah, it was. So that in itself was...
That's fascinating.
It is.
That's a historian's dream, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It is. This living history, just to be able to sort of interact with these sort of these things,
Peeling back the layers, it's like studying trees, isn't it, with the rings?
Yeah, it is. It is. That's true. Yeah. So, so is your book sort of about the politics on the goldfields
No, not really. It's about the diamond mines.
Okay.
It's the location for the start of a story about a particular woman.
Okay.
Really?
Sure. All right. Okay. Sure. Does it look at the practicalities and the sort of the
It does. When she's only seven there, and she's been taken there by her father, who also took the mother. The mother went voluntary, but she died. Mm. She died of a fever.
Oh, did she?
And the father was had to bring up the child, and then they took on board a Zulu. Warrior, really, he was.
Right,
and
yes.
he was. It's a lot. I won't go too far into it, but the father couldn't cope with the grief, and he took to the bottle.
Yeah.
So the main job of bringing up the child or caring for the child fell to this Zulu warrior who was helping him dig.
Wow.
And then somebody from the family, there was a rich side to the family, came over and got her.
Yep.
And the father died, and so it goes on. But but she's about to return to Africa to find out some further facts about what went on in terms of dealings with diamonds that were found and stuff like that belonging to her.
Yes, because people used to try and swallow them and shepherd them away, didn't they? There was all sorts of
stuff. Yeah. Well, they made a great find of a huge diamond, and they hid it in her favourite doll. Sewed it in there.
Okay, how interesting. Wow.
Yeah.
Gosh, it sounds quite compelling.
But it is a very, very interesting. But as I say, in the course of the first part of it, there are very vivid descriptions and apparently very well researched of life, in the diggings.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, that's good. Now, it's important to get those historical perspectives. It really sort of fuels the imagination, I think. And,
absolutely.
Yeah. I've got a book I'm really keen to read, but I'm going to save it for Deal Island. So I've got that all set aside.
Yes,
that's the Burke and Wills book, the Fitzsimons book on
Burke. Peter Fitzsimons, yes.
Yeah, I quite enjoy his writing. So,
oh, yes, he writes well.
He does. I read his book on the Eureka Stockade last year, and I thought that was great.
Yeah. This book I'm talking about is called The Diamond Hunter, if ever you...
Yeah, sure, thank you. I will remember that. Sounds good. Yeah.
It's actually being read. It's being read on Vision Australia Radio.
Is it? Okay. Oh, very good.
Yeah.
Sure.
It is.
Oh, that's good to know. Yeah. Excellent. Alrighty,
see ourselves for Christmas.
Yeah, that's good.
What are your plans for over Christmas?
Well, let's see. I haven't thought that far ahead. No, Christmas Day. we're here this year, which is last year we were up on Kate's sister's farm. But when we're here as a family, we'll just be chilling out. Kate's invited some people over on the evening who don't have anyone to be with on Christmas night.
No, that's lovely.
That'll be good.
We used to have dad's sisters who were either widows or maiden aunts, and that was a lovely thing too.
Sure, yes, that's good.
So is it going to be a lot of work for Kate?
Well, look, it's pretty ad hoc here, and it'll be a family thing at lunchtime. I think we're going to my sister's place, I think, which will be good because she's. Yeah. hasn't got the easiest plight. He's got a disabled daughter, and and she's her husband passed away a few years ago. So we'll be spending lunchtime with her, and that'll be good. Look forward to seeing her. She hasn't sort of. It's been COVID's been pretty tough for her because having a disabled child in the midst of all
I can well believe it. Yes, it's tough enough for anyone, isn't it?
It is. So So that's that'll be good to see her and in her territory, and then in the evening we're just sort of having an open house and we'll be having people drop in. It'll be good. I'm looking forward to just seeing some of Kate's community, and we'll just all be milling, and as it happens here, it's just like an open house, really. I don't think we ever lock doors on ourselves. I shouldn't say that on air.
No.
But stuff happens. It just sort of, there's always someone here. So, that's always a good thing.
Yes.
I've been listening to lots of Jacob Collier in the car.
Yeah.
Mr. H.
Well, I love that stuff tonight.
It's good. It's good. There's some great. Now, his album, Jesse 2, is mostly acoustic material, and I elected to hear that today, and so for a good part of our 3.5 hour trip back, we were enjoying that. That was good, really good.
Great.
Yeah, that's wonderful material. I love its complexity, and it's just sort of impulsive in a way, but it's delightfully impulsive and just sort of curious and exploratory, and I always enjoy that about Mr. Collier's conceptions. So, now, it was interesting sorry, go on.
The harmonies that he has are just incredible. As you say, they sound impulsive, but surely he must have given them some thought because...
I think he has. But there's a certain sort of freshness about the ideas that sort of permeates everything. So I think that he's able to sort of amplify an idea quite quickly, and without sort of over exploring it to the point of losing its freshness or its, its qualities, and he works between different intonation schemes a lot. So that's an interesting quality as well. So he'll move from even temperament to a just intonation to Pythagorean intonation to.
Oh my God!
So the music it just sort of surfs through all these zones, and Mr. H, who's with me, is explaining all this to me, and
he'd be a very good guide for you.
Oh, look, he's great, and it's a lot of it's beyond my ear. I mean, I hear it and I experience it and I relish in it, but I could never be able to describe it. It's just so complex. It's fascinating. It's wonderful to hear sort of people moving into new zones and being having those, So look at it. That's exciting. So Mr. Collier is still producing things. I was hearing that it's very common now to streaming is the new sort of go-to space. I've been asking lots of questions and trying to sort of understand the way that communications working with the younger generation. It intrigues me, the whole sort of gaming frontier and all that sort of stuff. Streaming is everything. Now we've moved, the younger generation have moved away from sort of static stuff, a static presentation to streaming. And it's very interesting that people really want the live experience.
And do they?
They're yearning for it. So apparently there are lots of people, doing music streams or exploring things, and, people can just watch them explore and develop their, their project. And in the same way with
games. So it's to do with spontaneity.
Yeah, it is. People are seeking that. And I think that's quite fascinating and really important that we sort of, it's a part of our condition, I think, is to sort of want to be, in a living, breathing space. So
it's the lifeblood of jazz, of course.
It is. Well, jazz by nature is just free association, a lot of it. Within structure.
Free within rules.
That's right. It does have rules.
But improvisation, since practically the beginning of it has been central to it.
Yeah, definitely. I agree. Yeah. And it'd be interesting to hear about sort of gaming culture as well, which is huge with young communities. It's just bigger than Texas. And how
it's huge.
Yeah. And how now the next big thing is sort of gaming houses. So people communities of people live in a house and everyone's gaming and people are watching them game. So it's like it's like reality TV.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it's that's the sort of the type of connection. It intrigues me. It's interesting. So
it's incredible.
Yeah. So that's the sort of new frontier. And there's YouTube's now in the for the you know the 18 to 25 is yeah. sort of is secondary. There are other sort of modalities which are far more slick and these people, these gaming houses, and there's millions, thousands of them, and they all have tens of thousands of people watching them all the time. So this is the new sort of media.
Good heavens, this is incredible.
It's completely fascinating.
It's amazing.
It's just intriguing how this sort of developing in that way.
And the games are these complex computer games.
Yeah,
which
they're complex. They're interactive.
Reality.
Yes.
Yeah.
They're pseudo reality. They're presenting sort of
situations
which are interacted with. Maybe a war type situation. It may be evolution of a civilization. It may be a historical drama of one type or another, but they're complex sort of with the rules are just they stagger me. I was sort of inquiring about this, and the level of complexity and the how much investment one has to make into to sort of to become involved is just completely mind-boggling. It blows me out of the water. I couldn't imagine being that dedicated to a cause like that, a recreational cause like that. Yeah.
Well, you need a very powerful computer to start with, don't you?
Yeah, you do need a fair bit of. You need a lot of RAM, definitely, because there's
a lot of RAM. Yeah.
So because you need to upload worlds, and you need to have a sort of an interactive perspective on the world and the ether somewhere. And you're just working with other people and you've got avatars and that's all sort of, it's quite seamless, really. It's amazing. This VR, the whole concept of virtual reality is just really permeating the experience of a lot of young people. That was intriguing. It was quite a topic. So, it was good to hear. Now, I've tentatively put up a couple of quick things because we probably haven't got a lot of time for music tonight. But I was having I haven't looked at YouTube for days. Look, one of the great things about this walk and stuff is it's just been completely offline, which is just so important. And so I came back on and there's a few remarkable things that have popped up. And one of them is a cellist, Maurice Marechal, a French cellist who I just admire so much. I just love his playing. And he's got that very in the string sound. It's very, he's got the most incredible longbows, legato sense, and it's very intense French playing. And he plays the 4A Elegy. Now, I have heard this before a long, long time ago, but he plays it so well. And I'd love to share it with you. So maybe we could have a couple of minutes of repose and have a listen to this performance from 1928. Goes way back. Now, Marechal was the cellist who had a cello on the in the trenches. Which is so he had a packing case cello and he sat there practicing in the trenches while the bombs were all falling around him.
So that's living in the moment, isn't it?
It certainly is. And there's some remarkable pictures of him just in these war zones with this packing case cello practicing away. And just to think that this actually happened, and this recording was only made a few years after that. So, it's quite striking. So, shall we have a listen to the Elegy by Gabriel Fauré, a piece very close to my heart. I've played this many times. Yeah, let's have a listen.
Let's go.
Thank you.
You just heard Fauré's Elegy, a recording made in 1928 with the Maurice Beautiful. Show. Isn't it beautiful playing?
Oh, God.
Yeah, incredible.
Just such warmth. And...
Yes, definitely. And in beautiful sense of line, lovely sense of legato, and that free French high-speed vibrato.
Whoa, yeah, I love it.
It's beautiful, and it's quite different. It's very idiosyncratic, but I just think it's a great sort of reflection of a different time and place. And different, and a great vision of the work. And he would have been close to Fauré. It's really, it's got a special stamp of authenticity, I think, because of
his.
He would have known Fauré very well, Mr. Maréchal. And and he's got a great story. I mean, the thing he played in the trenches. Oh,
well, that is incredible, isn't it?
It is.
Just is unbelievable.
It certainly is.
To think that he could so abstract himself from his surroundings.
Yeah, totally. Absolutely. So that was one thing that's popped up online. So it was good to hear that again. And it's a nice transfer. It's not over-processed. I've got that on a couple of anthologies, and it's so hopelessly over-processed that you lose a lot of the overtones and the nuance, and I much rather hear a bit of scratch accompanying.
Yeah, of course. It seems to be pretty full-on rich.
Yeah, sort of. It's got a lovely rich sound there. It sounds like a different performance. I'm delighted to hear that being put up into the pub domain. Yay, so that's a good thing, but I haven't really looked at much else. It's been all go since I've returned back to the coal face. Yeah.
Yes. Oh, well, you'll have time now to get back on the ground and.
Now tonight was actually a very spontaneous evening because this was all Kate's extended family, and we usually have a whole weekend with them, and we've done that for decades. And Kate's mum is not as well as she was, and that's now not happening. So Kate off the cuff just rang everyone and said, "How about coming over here and dropping in any time?" And it was a great thing because they all sort of descended and we were able to have dinner together. But everyone contributed, and it was a very merry evening actually. So it was
wonderful. That's excellent.
So it all went very well. Yay!
What the holidays are all about, isn't it?
It certainly is. It's the season. Yay!
It's the season.
It certainly is.
I do love Christmas. As you say, it has no religious significance for me. So many memories of great Christmases.
Well, a lot of it's about family time and reposeful time, reflective time. And those qualities are really important. They can never be underestimated.
I think the best Christmas I ever had, or the best Christmas present I ever got, was when I was 13. I got an AR-8.
Ah, really? So what's the story there, Frank? Did your parents go and go to the disposal store and get you one?
Yeah, from Smith. Snowy Milburn was the guy.
He
had amateur. He was specialised in amateur radio gear.
I used to go to Snowy's in Hyatt Street in Richmond.
Yes, in his later years.
But go on, tell us.
Oh yes, it was, and I had been using a dual wave Stromberg Carlson receiver, but the dial cord had broken, and for some reason that wasn't. Fixed. It wasn't possible to fix it. So I was tuning 20 metres from the back of this, with the big wheel.
Oh, yes, he's putting your hand inside, just careful not to touch something.
It was about a quarter of an inch to cover or half an inch to cover the whole band.
Sure.
And then I went from that to this lovely vernier dial.
Oh, they've got beautiful vernier dials, the AR-8. I use one here. It's the main station. You know the story. Yay. So your father, what foresight? Isn't that wonderful?
I know. Well, he had a number of amateur friends who were in South Melbourne.
Mm-hmm.
And there are four or five of them. One of them became my main mentor, really.
Okay.
And yeah,
sure.
He worked. He was a linesman with the PMG.
Right.
This guy.
Yeah, yeah.
But and I'd go down to his house and talk on 20 metres.
Okay, so he used to let you participate.
Oh, he encouraged me to. Yeah.
Oh, that's wonderful. Great. Yeah. Fantastic. So he was a friend of your father's, you say?
Oh yes, he was. Yeah, he was. But I used to listen all the time on 20 and 40. And when I worked, I had to work out there were two different. At each end of the dial, you struck these guys who were talking, the most interesting stuff. Mm. And so I asked him about it, and he told me, he found out more. Then these other guys would come and talk to me and explain stuff to me. Yeah, wonderful. Yeah.
Sure. Okay.
I was about 11.
Oh, my gosh, that's great. So your father, what foresight? So he got you an AR-8. Was it one of those ones in a cabinet with a little oval speaker at the top? Or because I've seen in old Radio Hobbies magazines, they sort of repackaged them in a little sort of ensemble.
And you plug the speaker in.
Yeah.
It had that.
Okay.
It had that.
Oh, very good. And so you used to use it with a loudspeaker or headphones? What was your preferred?
Loudspeaker.
Okay, sure.
But I also had a pair of cans that I would use if people were trying to sleep and that sort of thing.
Because people have sort of modified them, and they didn't we've had this conversation with Dave before, but, I mean, he made the video about the AR-8 I've got here. And you, really, with a high-efficiency speaker, you really don't need the
The extra audio stage.
You don't at all. It works perfectly well.
Well, this had been tweaked so that it went up to about 21.4. It just about got all of 15 meters in.
Really? Fantastic.
And it was pretty sensitive, really.
Yeah.
But it was just wonderful to. And I used to love to listen down on the Beacon Band and hear the NDBs.
Sure.
Because they were very good. And it was also very sensitive, very good for, as you would know, for shortwave broadcast stuff.
Yes, indeed. Absolutely it is.
You could not possibly overload it.
Yeah.
And it didn't do cross-mod.
No, that's right, indeed. So yours had a power supply built into the sort of the whole cabinet thing? Is that how it worked?
It did, yes. There was no external transformer or anything
like
that. Okay,
sure. So it was just a plug-in and go, and had been sort of adapted. Well,
the two dials in the front, of course.
Yes. I love the geometry of it. I think it's a really, it has a lovely feel to it, that set.
And the handles, the handles.
Yes, two. I'm looking at one right as we speak. Look at this one here, and I'm looking at that. Yeah.
I'm just remembering it, just picturing it.
Yes, and there's a particular type of, the knobs are really good to use with gloves.
Oh, yes, the long, with the long points.
Yes, that's right, exactly. So they're sort of very ergonomic and
so well.
Comfortable.
But anyway,
feel.
I thought I'd died and gone to heaven when I got this.
And fantastic. And there's the lovely birdie dials. Yeah.
Yeah. And the sensitivity. I mean, the Stromberg Carlson was really didn't have enough gain. It just brought band noise into the picture on 20 meters.
Yeah, for sure. I can understand. Wow, so you're listening on 20. That's fantastic. And what did you do for an antenna at that age? Did you have a system?
I had a wire from we had two chimneys in this house, and it went from one chimney to the other.
Right.
It was an inverted L.
Okay, sure. And you just brought that down?
Okay, but
did you have an earthing stake as well?
Sorry?
Did you have an earth as well, a stake?
Oh, yes, I had an earth outside, but it was just a pipe into the ground.
Sure.
And I connected it up to the water supply as well. Mm-hmm.
Sure.
And that more or less took care of that. But the big bugbear was noise, and we were close to a light engineering works where they had an arc welder. And when that was on, it just put me off the air altogether.
Oh, that's a shame. That would have been frustrating.
It was. But on the evenings and weekends were fine. It was just during the
day. Yeah, just during the day. Okay. And then you moved up to an AR-8. You had an AR-8 as well, didn't you, at one stage?
I had an AR-88.
Yes.
I did. That was a few years on.
Yeah. Okay.
And, of course, that was...
Did that come from Snowy's as well?
Yes. No. And I bought that out of a newspaper ad.
Oh, okay.
And it came down from somewhere in New South Wales.
Oh, my goodness. Okay.
And my poor dad had to try and carry it.
Oh, that's a weight and a half. I know about
absolutely.
The back-breaking AR-8s, 88s.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
But that, again, is, you know, technically was a step up.
Yes.
And it covered 10 metres.
That's right. Yep. And I think I've heard you say yours had the long wave as well, didn't you? You had a long wave.
Yes, it was. Well, not as well. It had it instead of the broadcast.
That's right. Instead. Yeah. Yeah. The one here does the same.
Either there was the D and the LF.
That's right. The LF
one or the other.
That's exactly it. Yeah. Yeah, yes, the lovely weighted tuning dial on those.
Beautiful dial! Mm. Yes, had a lovely feel to it. Lovely, as you say, weighted, and it just spun. It just had a right level of spin. You know.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, yes. Very nice underhand. Very good. Oh, that's nice to hear. Yeah.
Anyway, it's Christmas time. I think about the ARA.
Yes, you would if it was a special gift and if it was a important moment. So, when did you go for your call?
Look, this is a great shame, really. As I say, my interest started in the early 50s, mid 50s, and I didn't go for my call until 78.
Okay. Sure.
So I didn't get my act together, really.
Okay, well, that's all right. But you were listening and you were active.
I think I was quite happy listening.
Yeah.
I think that's what it was.
That's fair enough.
I did a lot of listening. I listened a great deal.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'd have probably gone on listening a lot longer, but a friend. Who was a physics teacher, as it happened, said he shared my interest in amateur radio, and he said, "Look, why don't we go to the WIA and do a course, and then we sit for our ticket."
Yeah,
and that's what happened. Really.
Okay, so you went along with him. That's it. It sounds like
I did.
Yeah, it's good if you can share it with somebody. It makes a big difference too.
It does.
Oh, good on you, Frank. Yeah. That's good. So 78. What? You've been licensed for quite a while. That's good.
Oh yes, it's 42 or 43 years now.
And so, how did you find the CW? Because that would have been certainly in the picture back then.
I had to do 10 words a minute. It was very interesting because I practiced. They had these practice transmissions on VK2W. I had one on 80 metres. It still does, I think.
Yes.
And I did a lot of practice there, and somebody gave me a Morse practice set.
Yes.
I found harder, as I think everyone does, found harder than sending.
Than sending, yeah. Yeah.
When I came to do the exam, I had to do an oral exam because they couldn't work out how to do the. So I had to explain circuitry and stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah.
But with the Morse, they gave me the sending was no problem. They just gave me a text and I wrote that out in Braille and just read it and sent it.
Yeah.
But the receiving was a bit of a problem because. It was a bit hard. I hadn't practiced typing and listening at the same time.
Yeah, sure. No, I can appreciate that.
And it was a little bit of a problem, but so they let me. They just let me play the tape of what the text was, and I just managed to type it as I went.
Okay,
it was okay.
Okay. Oh, very good. That's great. I mean, I think actually the visual component is an impedance with learning CW. I think that it's very much a rhythm based sort of concept anyhow. So
very much. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, it is.
I find that intriguing. Yeah.
Yeah.
But. That's great.
I've never had a, to my shame, I've never had a CW contact. I promised Drew Diamond that the first one I ever have will be with him.
Oh, wow. Well, you should set it up. I'm sure he'd be more than keen because he's so passionate about it.
He loves it, doesn't he?
He certainly
good luck
does.
To him too.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
But I'd have to do a bit of practice too. I'm pretty rusty. But,
yeah, that's fair enough. No, look, it's a specialty field. It's just one of the many niches, the many little...
Did you have to learn it?
No, I didn't. See, I've come into the hobby quite recently.
Well,
as I've said, this hobby is my midlife crisis, really.
Yeah. You're amazingly knowledgeable and capable of working within it.
I don't think I am, but I do enjoy it, and it's been a technical discovery, and it's consolidated a lot of my thinking and made it help me understand the cause and effect of things a lot more. It's been really good in that sense. I don't make many contacts outside the outside these test missions and our contact and when we had the missions and occasionally a few other people here and there, maybe on holidays.
Sure.
It's not a terribly active hobby in that respect. It's probably more of a technical interest hobby. But, you know, but look, at the same time, it's been a really, really positive, you know, step, and it's been a natural progression in some ways, I suppose. You know,
great stuff.
You're getting involved.
That's the great thing about it. There are so many facets to it that you can pick and choose among.
That's right. And there are. I mean, it's a multidimensional thing. So, but it's very recent. I mean, I only became licensed in, 2012 or something like that.
Oh, okay.
It's not that, not that long ago. But I was listening to the missions in the early 2000s. Occasionally in the 90s, I struck upon it and didn't really know what it was. But that's the way it happened. And I did have some contact with Tony Sanderson before, just not long before he passed away. Yeah.
Was that through? Oh, did you?
Yeah, it was mainly email. I had some technical questions for him. I'd seen his website, and so I had a little bit of correspondence. I've still got his email somewhere, but So
one of my regrets is that I never met him.
Yeah.
Or spoke to him. Really. Sure. But I'd listened to him so much for so long. I felt I knew him.
Yeah. Yeah. He was an absolute stalwart on the air, wasn't he? He was really.
Oh, he was. He was. Yeah. Yeah. Was indeed back in the 70s. He and Dave really were the lifeblood of missions, you know, as you would know.
Yes, yes, definitely.
And very often they were both going at the same time.
Wow.
Having their own, he'd work with people who were, you know, particularly friendly with him, and Dave would work with Paul.
Yeah,
with Mr. Beck,
okay.
and others, and from time to time they would all meet up and have one big net.
Yeah,
there was no animosity.
No, it's great. I mean, look, it was a really lively institution, and I suppose before the days of mass communications and mobile phones and things, it had a particular proprietary. It was a very special mode, and I think probably a lot of people were listening because that's what you could do, whereas now we're in a completely different world, really. It's important to acknowledge that. I think that these earlier times, you know, there was a lot of it was quite an adventurous thing to do, really, and especially that notion of working cross-band, I think. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that was one of the things that appealed to me about the missions. It's far better to have a full duplex conversation.
Totally, it is.
Than
so much
make
more
5-minute speeches.
Exactly. I find the speech sort of concept very sort of truncated and one dimensional, really. But being able to have a normal conversation. But so I think for me, the hobby is really sort of a part of very much a part of a historical interest in the technology and the ways of things, and that's why the AM mode, earlier modes sort of resonate with me.
I think that's true of a lot of people who were in missions. Even today, you know.
Yeah, for sure. And I think it's just that interest in retro technology, I think, is a strong theme.
Why not?
And I've got this small working museum here, so it's sort of sort of fits the bill. But I do enjoy trying to understand. I don't think I do it very successfully, but I try and understand how things, the cause and effect, and how things work, and how they interface and impedance matching, and all of the peculiarities. Well, I don't know.
Certainly as well as I do, at least.
Make lots of mistakes. But there you go.
Well, that's the one way to learn, isn't it?
Well, it is, I suppose. But it's the intrigue. It's just the whole sort of technical frontier of it. But it's good to remember these things. Wasn't Dave's video interesting, the recent one?
Yes, it was.
I found that quite moving, actually.
I know.
The film with the Griffiths just to see the state of the place now is just,
Yeah,
and have that sort of flybacks to the earlier documents.
I used to listen to him from Griffiths quite a lot.
At
Shepparton, of course, he was.
Yeah.
He did. Oh, yes. He was.
Okay.
Because he was announcing at Griffiths, as you know.
Yes, yes.
And he used to talk a lot about that. He always has been a very good describer of the scene around him. He's very good picking up on detail.
Yeah, for sure. Absolutely. Definitely. No, that's one of the things that I find so compelling. I mean, so many people associated with this are very highly perceptive.
Yeah.
Mr. Stew is, Mr. Long is. I mean, look, they're people with really acute perceptions, and it just makes things come to life, you know. And
yeah, well, Tony was equally so,
it's great. Yeah, for sure. All right. Well, look, Frank, I suppose us getting to that witching hour, I'm sort of very much in borrowed headspace at the moment. I've sobered up a bit, but I'm also feeling...
you didn't show any signs whilst you were doing that.
I was probably a bit... Yeah, I don't know. maybe not.
I've got this lunch tomorrow, which is likely to involve a little celebration.
Yeah.
Liquid celebration.
Oh, good for you. Well, you enjoy yourself. Enjoy it.
Well, I will.
Yeah.
I will.
Well, look, I'll wind up today. I've got one more thing here. I've been reading all week about Mr. Moore, and I've really enjoyed the book. In fact, it's going to be a sort of a point of departure for me, because he mentions so many great artists he worked with, but he gives very specific examples of their art and of their, their vision and how he worked with them. And it's quite exacting, and it's humbling, and it's remarkable. And it's musically, I don't know, it makes the music come alive when you realize the level of involvement. And one of the artists that he just had such regard for was Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau.
Yes.
He made quite a lot of recordings with him. Mm. Now, I'm looking here if I can find it. Maybe I haven't got it here. I thought I did. Oh. I thought I'd dial it up. Maybe we might have to leave it.
All right.
Here we go. Yes, here it is. Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau and Joel Moore. From London, from the BBC. It's one of the Schubert songs, the Leidenbaum. Leidenbaum, I'm not sure what it's about. Im Frühling, it says. I'm not sure.
Right.
Anyhow, we'll listen to the songs, listen to the interaction. It's from the Winter Ice cycle.
Oh, yes.
And, so look, it's probably a nice way to finish. Two very great artists in dialogue, and it's, I mean, look, it's amazing to sort of to sort of conceptualize music making at this level. And now a 5 minute piece, maybe 5 hours of rehearsal, they just talking about how they dissect things, and there's so much sort of design about the song and its meaning, which is sort of it's been deconstructed and found and invigorated in musical terms. And that's a subject I don't know much about, and something I'd just love to learn more about. So maybe I'll just play this as a way of spurring my own imagination or something.
Look, it sounds excellent. Do look out for this documentary that he's done.
Yeah, I will, for sure.
I'm not sure whether it's an interview. Now that I think about it, I think it might be him just talking about.
Yeah, he spent the later years of his life giving lectures. He was gave lectures. He's a natural communicator, and he gave lectures on music. And I've got an LP here of him giving a talk, and I think I played it.
Maybe that's what I'm thinking of.
Yeah,
maybe,
it might be that. I played it in an early emissions, and it was wonderful. But I just realised that there's just so much he did, and it would be lovely to sort of keep the subject open. So I think, look, I'll play this to wind up. Now, just before I do so, I should mention that next week is Christmas night. So I don't...
Christmas Eve, actually, I think.
Is it Friday? Christmas is on Friday, isn't it?
No, Saturday.
Oh, is it? Okay.
Oh, sorry. No. My apologies.
Yeah.
My total apology.
No, that's fine.
It's Christmas Day is Friday. Yes.
It is Friday, Christmas Day. I don't know. I certainly won't be doing a long missions on... I probably won't do anything on Christmas.
No, I'd probably assume not.
Yeah, I think we might just give it a miss next week. And then I don't know what's happening thereafter because I think I'm in Harrodville the week after, and then it's sort of moving
into... Deal?
And the deal's on the 8th of January,
okay,
which is probably the week after. So I think there might be a bit of a hiatus. We'll have to just put a rain check on things because I haven't got my diary.
Sure.
But I'll certainly be in touch with you, Frank, and I can let people know on the blog page when we'll recommence with missions.
In any form.
So if listeners wondering what's going on, I'll just put a mention when we'll start again. But it could be quite some weeks, maybe well into January or even later. But Frank, I'll certainly be in touch with you anyhow, and
that's fine, Steve.
And we'll see how we go from there. But thanks to the listeners for your support, and
season's greetings to the listener.
Absolutely, yes. I'm wishing everyone a really warm and celebratory time with family and friends, and just peaceful time. And we'll look forward to your company down the track, and as we move into the into the Christmas season. So,
indeed.
Let's wind up. And thank you, Frank. And thank you for last week.
Please, thank you. And have a great Christmas to you and all your family.
And to you too, yeah.
Thank you. Yes, it will be good. It will most certainly be good.
Yeah, absolutely. All right then, best wishes to everyone. This is VK3SL and VK3JR saying cheers for now. Until next time, bye-bye.
Cheers from JR. Bye-bye.
Nun bin ich Auf den Zweig.